Welcome to the Business and Leaders Luncheon, supported and sponsored by the Government Affairs Council of your Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce. I'm Lynn Snodgrass, the CEO of the Best Darn Chamber in the Oregon, soon to be the Best Darn Chamber in the Pacific Northwest. That's our goal, and we're moving rapidly in that direction. I have some special thank yous. 2016 has been an incredible year for sponsorships of our members to the Chamber to allow functions like this to happen. And with that in mind, I want to give some extra special attention to the sponsors of our Business and Leaders Luncheon. So much so because we didn't do it last month. We didn't have a luncheon last month. We were celebrating our election day. Although in Oregon we don't have an election day, we have an election 3 weeks, as you know. But I want to thank some sponsors specifically today. And the first one I want to thank is Portland General Electric. John Maloney, would you raise so everybody knows who you are? Usually he is in, yeah, thank you. Usually he dresses like this, but fortunately he has had a snow cap on and boots and has done a yeoman's job at keeping the lights on for all of us the past couple of weeks with the weather, and I think it's going to come again, isn't it? This seems to be a little hot on the mic. Are we okay? In addition to the presenting sponsor of Portland General Electric, we also have presenting sponsor Riverview Community Bank. Larry, where are you? There, Larry. Oh, you're together. Aren't those sponsors together? All right. We do appreciate Riverview Bank as well. Larry does a great job at organizing the speakers to come to us. So if you like him today, you can thank him for it. If you don't like him, you can let me know. We'll keep him happy. Okay. There we go. I also want to thank our education sponsor, which is Gresham Barlow School District. Is there anyone here from the Gresham Barlow District? We are so grateful that the community passed their bond, and I wanted to acknowledge that accomplishment on their behalf. Thank you also to our media sponsor, MetroEast Community Media. Keith, we're grateful that you're here. You're drinking your coffee. And as always, there's flyers out on the counter listing the replay times of this luncheon. So if you miss anything because you laugh too hard, you can relook at this at the replay. So pick up the replay times that'll be on the registration table. We also would like to recognize elected officials that are here today. Now, if you are an elected official but haven't taken office, you don't have to stand yet, but we do have some elected officials. So anyone that is elected, would you please stand to make sure? Lori, Jerry, Kurt, thank you very much, our council members. And I also want to acknowledge my boss, who is a board member. He's my boss for another 26 days. Warner Allen. Warner from Warren Allen LLP. He's the president of the Gresham Chamber. And another board member that is with us today, John Maloney of Portland General Electric. John, again, we're grateful. Now, the way today is going to go, we have four amazing people that are going to speak to us. And each one of them gets 10 minutes. Some of them may want to talk longer. Casey. And or maybe not, and that's fine. But there is a time for questions, and what I thought we'd do today, because we're a smaller group, is we can ask questions in between each one, but if you have a question that you want to ask at the end, after all of them have spoke, we will give that opportunity as well. So 10 minutes for each one of them, their timeline, and then we'll ask one or two questions after that of each one of them, and as they finish their speech, and then the next one will come, we can ask a question. But at the end, there'll be one more shot at asking questions to any or all. So with that in mind, I want to again introduce the president of the Gresham Chamber so that he can then introduce each one of our speakers. Warner.
Thank you, Lynn. So it's my pleasure and honor to introduce our speakers today. And I want to start with Lori Stegmann, our newly elected Multnomah County Commissioner. Lori grew up in the Rockwood neighborhood after being adopted as an infant from an orphanage in Korea. She's been a small business owner and an insurance agent for more than 20 years, specializing in commercial insurance. She chose to live and locate her farmer's insurance agency in the same neighborhood she grew up in. Before being elected to the Gresham City Council in 2010, Lori served as the Gresham Planning Commission, or on the commission, the Rockwood Stakeholders Group, Rockwood Light Rail Station Art Committee, as well as Vice Chair of the Gresham Redevelopment Commission Advisory Committee. She's also served as a board member on the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce, and she is serving her second term on the Gresham City Council. So in 2014, Ms. Stegmann served as the City Council President. Her duties as Gresham City Councilor have included committee assignments on the Public Safety Committee, the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce, the Gresham Sister City Association, and the Youth Advisory Committee, as well as the Council Employee Performance Subcommittee. Lori put herself through college, graduating from Mount Hood Community College with an associate's degree, and then obtaining her bachelor's degree in business from Portland State University. Please welcome Lori Stegmann.
Thank you, Warner. It's great to be here. As Warner had said, that I was a board member for the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce, and a lot of times people kind of ask, like, how did you get involved in politics or start out? And I had no intention of being involved in politics. What I really wanted to do was to serve my community. And one of the ways I did that was through business, and I'm a farmer's insurance agent and have been an agent for 23 years. And then I'm also a Soroptimist, and many of you are familiar with Soroptimists. Our mission is to improve the lives of women and girls, and we have held the annual Teddy Bear Parade, I think, for close to 35 years, a really beloved event in Gresham. So that's kind of how I got here today. It's kind of been a whirlwind, and you know, you ever wake up and you're just like, wow, how did I get here? But it's really been a really exciting, fun, but challenging time. I've been campaigning for a year and a half, and I'm so pleased that with the support of the community that I won Multnomah County Commission District 4 and can represent East County. So I did want to introduce Rebecca Stavanger. Rebecca, raise your hand. Rebecca is my chief of staff. She's been with me for like a whole month now, I think, and she is amazing. If you don't know Becca, for the last 2 years, she has served as a community liaison for the East County Caring Community. And this is a monthly form that promotes cross-sector collaboration, and it includes representatives from schools, the healthcare system, law enforcement, social service agencies, the faith-based community, and several different government jurisdictions. So they use a community-based model to help identify and work on local issues like housing stability, youth employment, public safety, and human services. And so this work has been incredibly valuable, especially for East County, because we know that oftentimes we have to really struggle to get our voices heard so that we can fight for our fair share of resources. And the work that Becca has been doing for the last 2 years so much aligns with the work that I will continue to do as the future county chair. So we will take office, my team and I. We're still working out the details of two or three more hires, but we've been working really hard for the past 4 weeks, and we want to make sure that we're well prepared and we'll hit the ground running. So my priorities are the same as what they were in my campaign, which are jobs, education, and housing. And so to kind of put everything in context in my new role, many of you may know that the county is responsible for several capital projects, like the new central courthouse. We were lucky enough to get the East County Courthouse. Now we'll be working on a central courthouse in downtown Portland, as well as the new County Health Department headquarters. Also, the county is charged with maintaining many of the bridges in the area, and there's the potential that we'll be rebuilding the Burnside Bridge, so that will be another capital project. So these projects are all opportunities to support local jobs and local businesses. So what I want to do is work with organizations like Women in Trades, colleges like Mount Hood Community College, and local unions to figure out creative ways that we can connect folks, especially folks in underserved communities, to jobs, to family wage jobs. I'm also really excited about the work that our council, our Gresham Redevelopment Commission, has done on the Rockwood Rising redevelopment. If you don't know about it, it's where the old Rockwood Fred Meyer was. We'll be breaking ground in 2017. And again, this will be another source of economic development and jobs. Another area that I want to work on is the Summer Works Youth Program. Many of you may know Ricky Ruiz, who is now an employee at the city of Gresham. And Ricky grew up in the Rockwood neighborhood, and he has a great story that as a child, he remembered cutting through the gravel pit that is on the backside of the Rockwood, the back of Vance Park. And he had cut himself like on the barbed wire because they were trying to cut through so that they could go play soccer. So Ricky decided that, you know what, he wanted to make sure that kids in our neighborhoods had places to play futsal. So we have, I'm not sure, 3 or 4 futsal fields because of the work that this young man has done. And so that's just a really great example of how important it is to empower our youth so that they can make a really meaningful difference in their communities. The other thing I want to work on is education. Now, the county doesn't deal a lot with the schools, but what they do have are wraparound services through the Sun School programs. Also, through the school-based clinics, that's really important. I was just reading about Roosevelt High School, that this is their 30th year anniversary for school-based clinics, and how back in the day, this was a very, very controversial issue, and now people are clamoring to have school-based clinics here, as well as we are, too. We have one in Centennial, but we definitely would like to have another school-based clinic and or at least have those services expanded. So we all know that when kids can show up, if they're housed, if they're fed, if they're secure, then their chances of graduating from high school and earning a family wage increases greatly. So those are the types of services that I think the county can participate in and encourage our kids so that they can get those family wage jobs. The other area is, of course, housing. We have all seen the tremendous impact that the rising housing costs have had, especially on East County. And I believe that this is a regional issue, and that with the passing of the Portland Housing Bond, I am excited that there'll be more affordable housing being built, but more specifically throughout the Portland metropolitan area, as opposed to being concentrated just in East County or one particular neighborhood or area. The other thing that I'm very proud of is the partnership that the city of Gresham has had with a Home for Everyone coalition. And a quick update, and these numbers probably are a little bit old, but their goal was to provide 650 emergency shelter beds. As of about a month ago, they had 562 beds that have been provided this year. And they have opened up 5 shelters in about the last year or two. Another exciting thing that in 2015, all veterans were housed. The City of Portland and Multnomah County were recognized recently by the U.S. Interagency Council on Homelessness for their work in finding permanent housing for homeless veterans. Portland is the first city on the West Coast to be recognized by the White House and was part of the White House's mayor's challenge to end veterans' homelessness. So while we all think about homelessness and sometimes we are frustrated that it's not the solutions are not moving as quickly as we'd like them to, there have been wins. And this is a huge win, and I'm so proud of the efforts that this coalition has made in providing housing for homelessness, homeless veterans. The other area, I think Gresham has always been so innovative and creative, and I want to take some of those ideas and expand them countywide. We have a rental housing inspection program, and when I was out campaigning, there were a lot of complexes that were not in good condition, and I thought, boy, we really need to expand this program throughout Portland. So that's one of the areas I want to work on, as well as tenant education through organizations like the Community Alliance of Tenants. And moreover, the bottom line is that the more that we can get folks educated and trained and have them have access to family wage jobs, that will improve the economy and decrease the need for social services. So in conclusion, I just want to let you know how proud I am to have been a Gresham City Councilor, and how proud I am of the staff and our amazing police force and our fire staff. Gresham has always had kind of that pioneering spirit, that can-do attitude, and you've seen that in our creativity and our innovation. When you look at things like our net zero wastewater treatment plant, our 66-day industrial review permit process, our rental housing inspection program, and our garage to storefront program. Everything that I learned about good governance, I learned from my experience of being on the Gresham City Council. So I want to thank all of the councilors and the mayor and all of the staff. Your support has just been amazing, and I wouldn't be here without it. And I also want to thank the chamber for their support in my race. I'm excited to start and to represent East County and to ensure that our voice is heard and to make sure that we receive our fair share of resources. And one last thing, I want to invite you all to our council reception on Tuesday, January 3rd at 5:30 at City Hall. We'll be honoring Councilor Hinton and Eccles and myself. And then the next day, and Widmark, I'm sorry, Councilor Widmark as well. And everybody's invited. And then I'll be having my inauguration for County Commissioner on Wednesday, January 4th, I think at 5:30 at the library, the Gresham Library here in Gresham. So thank you all.
Okay, do we have questions from our supporting? Would you like to ask a question? Okay, hearing none, we'll move on to the raise your hand, but I think she was waving.
The school-based health clinic?
Yes.
So this is a great model, is it, where they put essentially health clinics, locate them in schools, because schools, as we know, often are, you know, community centers for many families. And so it's so much easier for a child to get treatment so they don't have to leave school. It also, you know, provides, you know, anything from immunizations to, you know, whatever emergency. And you don't even have to, it's for any kid can go to any of these school-based clinics. So they're just really convenient, and they're also, they don't cost anything. Now, if you have health insurance, they will bill your health insurance. But any child who needs health care up to the age of 18 can go to any one of these school-based clinics located throughout the Portland area. You know, I don't know, Lynn. I think it's kind of a well-kept secret. I know, especially for kids and parents at schools that do not have school-based clinics, because I know I talk to kids at Barlow, and they're like, well, can I go to the one in Centennial? And the answer is yes, you can. But if it's not right there on the premises, it's kind of out of sight, out of mind. So let folks know that there is a care at Centennial High School.
Well, actually, what I meant was, if a child goes to a clinic, are the parents then notified that the child went to the clinic to get whatever the care is that they
needed? I couldn't answer that, but I would imagine the answer would be yes, but I'm not sure about the legality.
Okay, thank you. Another question? If not, if you think of something, you can ask at the end. Warner?
Second up is the new mayor-elect for the city of Troutdale, Casey Ryan. Mr. Ryan's reputation as a positive force in his community captivated the attention and support of regional leaders, who agreed that he'd deliver the type of civic leadership you would expect of a mayor. He earned the endorsement of the mayors of Fairview, Gresham, Wood Village, Multnomah County Commissioner Diane McNeil, as well as the support of business interests, including your chamber. He's no lightweight when it comes to leadership positions. He played a prominent role in the reversal of the business culture of Gresham's M Bank, which went from near bankruptcy to profitability with his help. And he's participated in leadership roles with Mount Hood Community College Foundation, East Metro Economic Alliance, and as our own Gresham Chamber as a board member. Casey's well known in our community as an active participant on numerous boards. He has three times been selected by readers of the Outlook newspaper as a Reader's Choice Best Banker. He's twice received the Gresham Chamber of Commerce Golden Note Award, and he's the recipient of the Chamber's Business Excellence Award. MBank promoted Casey Ryan to a newly created position of Director of Retail and Support Services, oversight of all operations and the Central Services team. As the acquisition of MBank by Riverview continues, we expect to see Casey continue in a leadership role. So please welcome the newly elected mayor of Troutdale, Casey Ryan.
It almost doesn't sound like me. I'm like, wow, I did some of that stuff? Seriously. Not bad for a kid from Lowell County, right? You know, so, yeah, so... First off, I want to thank the Gresham Chamber for your endorsement. And I also have to give, I don't know where Farhad went, but with me today I have Farhad Dadko and Brooks Longoria, who I work with at MBank and who were good supporters of mine. And Farhad became a citizen in the United States a couple of years ago. And he was, there he is. He went out and knocked on tons of doors with me. And you know, when you come from a country where you don't have democracy, and then you come to the United States, you become a citizen, you know, I mean, the fact that he got to vote this year and knock on doors, and he got to participate in real democracy, you know, and so I want to thank you guys for all your support and everything we went through. So, I don't know, Lori, you're a lot more polished in this than I am, but first off, I want to congratulate you, Councilor Stegmann, and I'm very excited to start work with you, and I was really rooting for you to win. Councilor Hinton, congratulations. Thanks for your endorsement, Councilor French. So how did I get to where I'm at? I don't know. This is exactly how this went. I got a phone call on a Friday afternoon from a detective from the Multnomah County Sheriff's. Tuesday was a deadline to run for mayor. And he said, I was driving somewhere, and he goes, you know, your name's been tossed around a little bit. Would you consider running for mayor? Yep. We talked for two more seconds, and I got off. And then I went home and I told my fiance, I said, hey, what do you think about me running for mayor? She goes, well, what does that look like? I don't know, but I just committed to it. And that's kind of been the way I've done things in my life. But so I had to get 25 signatures. I had to get them turned in. And all of a sudden, I was running against a city councilor that I've never met. And I just met him last Tuesday night. And so I shook hands and stuff. But I tell you what, you don't understand what it is like to run a campaign and be part of one until you do it. Wow. I mean, I didn't run for a year and a half. I couldn't imagine doing it for a year and a half. But in the, I don't know, what, 60 days that I did it, it was a lot of work, and it's just an up and down ride. But coming out of it, I'm a much stronger person than I was going in, that's for sure. So I don't know a lot of people in here from Troutdale, but we can talk about Troutdale if you like, because I think there's some things that affect Troutdale that affects the whole East County area. So the number one thing is, you know, I've hit the ground running. I've met with just about everybody you need to meet with, I believe, so far. But we have some unique things going on. So I've been told I might be the first mayor in the history of Troutdale, I'll be the 29th mayor, to never sit on council to then become mayor. So that's created some, you know, whatever in the community. And we have a new city manager coming. So we have me as the first time mayor, and we have a city manager, Craig Ward, who's leaving at the end of December, and we have an intern right now, Ray Young, who's a municipal judge right now. So he'll be filling at least a 4-month term, and then we'll see how it goes from there. So that'll be interesting. But I've met with Ray, and we've discussed things and talked, and then... yeah, so we're going to be doing that. You guys probably read the Outlook. I think it was in the Friday paper. There could be an interesting business at land on the Trip property there in Troutdale. Amazon may or may not be locating there, so we're not sure. But I have heard at least 1,000 jobs would be created there, and I heard somewhere if it does happen, there might be 50 management jobs of some sort, you know, if you do some research on Amazon and stuff. So. Honestly, that's good for the whole area because hopefully we get some more housing and more people moving out here to Gresham, Fairview, Wood Village, even East Portland, so, and in Troutdale. Let me think here. I wrote a few notes. Some of the things, and people ask me, why did I run? And there was more into it than the decision to run was really quick, but once I started looking into it, and the more I've gone through the election, I'm definitely not the same person I was when I decided to run the end of August, but the one thing that I've learned through the process is that it's very important for councils to be transparent. And I believe what's happened in Troutdale is that the general public feels like we're not transparent enough. And so I made a commitment to watch every single council meeting. So I'm spending a lot of time on East Metro Community Media watching council. I've started at the very first one of last year, and I'm going to watch every single one, and I've watched a ton. And so one thing I've seen is process is super important. And I think that if the process doesn't look like it's transparent and open, and I went to a class at Portland State University on Saturday for newly elected officials, and that's one thing they said too, is that you can actually do bad policy if the process looks open and transparent. And so, not that we'd want to do that, but the fact is there's something to be said about that. So that's one thing I want to bring. And one thing I think as a mayor, where we are right now in the city is that I think a good mayor will be a good facilitator. And that's one thing I ran on, is leadership. My number one agenda was bring civility and professionalism to that council. Other than that, I don't have a big dog in the fight on a lot of stuff. Now, when you run for office, you get thrown around in a lot of different places. And, you know, I stayed off the forums quite a bit, but once in a while I'd go on there. And it's amazing to have people who are rooting for you and rooting against you, and you haven't met any of them. You know, that was a weird thing to deal with. But I believe that you have to judge your public and where they're at. And I believe the city of Troutdale, I don't believe they trust their counselors as much as they should. And over the last year and a half or 2 years, there's been some very big issues that have come in front of the Troutdale City Council, and a lot of 4-3 votes. A lot of 4-3 votes means there's going to be a lot of tension, a lot of division. And I think that we have to mend that, and we have to build trust. And I'm really excited about the two counselors that were elected new. That would be Councilor Hudson and Councilor, soon to be Councilor Lauer. I think that they will bring some civility and some teamwork. And you've read a lot in the paper about, you know, one side having a majority and one side having a minority. And I've been very critical of the outlook on that, because the three people coming in have never voted. So if you've never voted, you can't be a minority or a majority. And so I want to make sure that we continue to work forward with the outlook to make sure that we're not creating this divisiveness that we don't need. And I believe that the more of the council meetings I watch, the more we will have a lot more in common than we don't, you know. And so I'm excited about bringing leadership to the council. I'm excited about finishing our downtown. We're very close, you know. There's one part next to the Troutdale Vision Center that needs to be completed. And I know Bremer Construction has plans for that. But they put the townhomes in the back. And so they've been sold too. So they've done the 5 they've sold, and they're building the other 5. And I believe they haven't pre-sold or very close. And we have so many great, you know, we got Mr. Caswell, Rip Caswell, who's doing a lot. He's committed himself a lot to the city and the downtown. And you saw the mayor, the mural at Mayor Square. And so, you know, those are the kind of things that Troutdale has to offer that not every city does. And that's one thing I was very passionate about when I was running, was the fact that Troutdale is, I always felt, it's like they're a poker player, or they think they're a poker player. And they have a winning hand, but they don't know how to play poker, so they keep folding, and they could win every hand. And that's what Troutdale is. I mean, very few cities in the metro area have their own airport. They're 15, maybe 20 minutes away from an international airport. They're at the mouth, basically, of the Columbia and the Sandy. They're at the mouth of the Gorge, right? I mean, one of the most historic things that we have in Oregon. We have a cute downtown. We have the Trip property, where we have, you know, FedEx. Maybe we have another large company coming in. The high school is located in Troutdale. We're at the neighborhood of the Mount Hood Community College. We have a world-renowned artist in our community, in Rip Caswell. And we have all these things going for us. And what we need to do is get on the same page and start working together on that. Because there's more things to be excited about than not being excited. And I guarantee you, there's a lot of communities in the metro area that wish they had that. You know, another thing is we have access off 84. Our downtown is easy to get in and out of too. You don't have to go too far to get it. So that's it. I'm excited about that. I'm excited about getting to work. I do know after I won, I mean, when the numbers came back, we knew pretty much then I'd won. And it was, you know, I think anybody that's ran for office and won probably was like, oh no. Because you are so focused, and I know Speaker Snodgrass knows that, you're so focused on campaigning. There's a big difference between campaigning and now being elected official. And I spoke with Speaker Snodgrass a few times through this, and, you know, some people are really good at campaigning, and some people are really good at managing and leading. I don't know yet. I felt like I was a good campaigner. It's yet to be seen if I'm going to be a good leader. So that's all I got.
We'll end on that high note. Do any of you have a question for Mayor-elect Casey? John, hold on. Here comes a mic.
Hi there. I was just wondering what your career path has been to where you're at today, business-wise and so forth.
Okay, so I moved here, February of, I moved to the area from Bend in 05, August 05. And I went to work for Riverview Community Bank, and I worked there for 8 years. And through that time, I knew nobody when I first got here. So the first person I met was Commissioner McKeel. She was the commissioner then. She was the executive director of the West Columbia Gorge Chamber. And I was so excited to work for Riverview. And I was in Walmart, right? And I was just like, oh my gosh, I got a job, and I got a salary. And I was so excited I could take care of my family. And I did, at that time, I didn't know what a Rotary Group was, a Chamber of Commerce, anything. So I met Commissioner McKeel, and we started talking, and all of a sudden, I was like this Energizer bunny. I got involved in everything. And then what I did find out, first I decided everybody thought I was so great, but then what I found out later is the fact that they want you to serve on their boards because they're just looking for energy and they're just looking for people, and a lot of people don't want to volunteer their time. So I got involved, and I was overcommitted in a lot of ways, but I was involved in a lot of boards, and then I became president of the boards. And then my career path at work was just going well, and I got more responsibility and yada, yada, yada. And so kind of that, right? And so I've served as the president of quite a few different boards, Mount Hood Community College, East Metro Economic Alliance. And I've been on a lot of boards. I've been on the East Portland Chamber Board, the West Columbia Chamber Board, Gresham Chamber Board. And what I said through the whole thing is I was very lucky, A, to work for Riverview, who gave me a lot of latitude to be able to do the things that were comfortable for me. And B, I was lucky to surround myself with really good people. And I was very lucky to meet a lot of quality people who took this person who was raw, and I was smart enough to listen and learn from people there. But if I never had a career path, I never thought, I'm going to do this, and this, then I'm going to be Mayor Troutdale. If you would ask me a year ago that you'd be the mayor of Troutdale, I would say there's no way, you know. So, in fact, I had a conversation with Bess Wills last summer, and the rumor is you're going to run for mayor. And I'm like, I laughed it off. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm not going to do that. And I'd forgotten about it to the point when the person called me, I'd forgot I had that conversation. So, it just wasn't something I thought I would ever do. So.
So you listed a number of assets that Troutdale has, including the Trip property, the downtown cute area. You didn't mention, however, the urban renewal area.
Yeah.
So how's that as an asset?
Ooh. Well, I was the original. I mean, I voted on that 10 plus years ago to have urban renewal there. I've done a lot of research. Let me tell you what. So one thing I do is I go out and I just meet with as many people as I can. And one thing I've found is there's not a lot of facts, but there's a heck of a lot of opinions, which makes it harder to form your own opinions when you're trying to take other people's opinions on stuff. I don't know where that's going to go. I want something to go there. I don't know if the current thing we have now will go there. I didn't run for that. Like, it was very common, you know what I mean? But it's an important issue. I hope that we can get something there. I hope that the divisiveness that's caught in our community over this, that we can move past that. The more I learn about it, the more I've found out that there's not black and white with those issues. There's a lot of things at stake, and there's taxpayers, and there's all these things that you have to factor in. And I come from the business world where it's a little bit easier. It's either kind of black and white in some cases. And I'm finding out here that it's just not, you know, so. I hope that I can stand up here 4 years later and say that we were able to work together and we got a great project there. But as of right now, I don't know. So,
anybody else have a question for now? If not, thank you, Mayor. Right, yeah.
Thank you for your time.
Appreciate it.
Good job.
Number three is Gresham City Councilor Jerry Hinton. So Jerry was first elected to council position one in November of 2012 and sworn into office on January 8th, 2013. 2 short years later, his colleagues elected him to serve as 2015 council president. Prior to joining council, Councilor Hinton served on the city's finance committee starting in 2011 and on the citizens involvement committee. He is the general manager of Brasher's Portland Auto Auction, has lived in Gresham since 2003, holds a Bachelor of Science degree from Brigham Young University, Master's in Business Administration from National University, and a law degree from Concord Law School. Yay, lawyers. Economic development, job creation, long-term stability of city finances, and creating a family-oriented community are among his top council priorities. With my background, I think I can help with that, he says. At the end of the day, the city is a business. Councilor Hinton's committee assignments include the Citizen Involvement Committee, Finance Committee, East Multnomah County Transportation Committee, and the Metro Policy Advisory Committee. Please welcome newly re-elected Councilor Jerry Hinton.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Appreciate the chamber and your endorsement. Appreciate inviting me here today, Lynn and Warren. Warner, appreciate that. You know, the really interesting ones today were Councilor Stegmann, Councilor elect Commissioner Stegmann, and Mayor-elect Ryan. Appreciate what you've indicated today, what your plans are, your goals are. I think you guys are why people came today to listen to you guys. I am just the filler today, and so I'm just going to roll through this. And again, it's a pleasure to be here. It's an honor to be able to serve at the city council level. I never had any aspirations for a city council or politics in general as well. My father served as a city councilor in his small city of Hurricane, Utah, years ago, and said that, you know, it's a very rewarding thing to do, to give back to your community. And that's really all I ever wanted to do as well. Like the other individuals who spoke just previously, that they just wanted to serve their community, serve their fellow man. I was raised to always give back and to provide service to other people from my youth. And so I think that's kind of the focus that I've had, and certainly have no aspirations for anything other than that. You know, and I like the ability to be able to serve in the small town environment. I really do. At the city level, I think you have a lot more impact in the ability to change the quality of life of our citizens, more so than other elected positions, possibly in the state or in the national government. I think you have more immediate impact in your community, in a nonpartisan position in your community, and that's why I really appreciate that. Just, you know, I think all of you have probably heard of Machiavelli, right? Niccolo Machiavelli, 15th, 16th century. His coined phrase, the end justifies the means. You know, believe it or not, that guy, who was a philosopher, a historian, a humanist, a politician, a diplomat, he was actually the modern day father of politics, of political science. Isn't that a little frightening, a little scary? He also was the one who, in terms of cunning and duplicity, created that form of statescraft. That's why I like the local level better. I'm not even going to get into that other area. And those who do, God bless them. And I pray that they will continue to do a good job on our behalf. But for me and my family, we appreciate the local level and want to serve those who I can have a more of immediate impact. You know, to that end, you know, NASA, I just met Apollo 13.
Just met who?
Fellow from Apollo 13, Jim Lovett. Jim Lovett, a couple weeks ago. Fantastic individual, right? He everybody saw the Apollo 13 movie with Tom Hanks. Thank you. This is going to be an interactive process here, okay? You know, I was told that when you get older, you know, you've got more files, and you got to go through those files to find what you're not. And if you're a millennial, you got one file that goes straight to it. So anyways, it's going to be interactive. So Jim Lovett, he tells me this story a couple weeks ago about NASA back in the early 60s, how they wanted to invent a pen that would write upside down, right? They thought, you know, they're going to need that up where there's no gravity. They need to be able to write upside down. And so they spent millions of dollars creating that pen that'll write upside down. Well, guess what? What did they use in the meantime?
Pencil.
A pencil. So they used a pencil. That's local city government at its basic level. We need to be able to use a pencil, because at the end of the day, the greatest responsibility of government is the safety of its citizens, not to create all these crazy programs that get in the way of business. We need to stay out of the way of business. We need to let them do their thing. We need to let Adam Smith's invisible hand take what its course is, and that is to let the markets control themselves. We need to stay out of the way of business. Now, in doing so, there's things that local governments can do to help expedite and grease the way for business to be functioning. What I love about Gresham is we think outside of the box regarding those things. We've got this 66-day permit process. I believe it's unparalleled in the Pacific Northwest. We were just at, many of us, at the Subaru plant. It's unveiling a week ago, and they went on and on about this being something that they had from home office in Japan saying, we need to do this. We need to do this. And they thought there was no way possible that a local government would provide that kind of expedition in terms of getting permits. Well, guess what? It happened, and there they are, and it's a great process. And they absolutely endorsed that process and endorsed the fact that they thought that there's no other jurisdiction in the whole Pacific Northwest that could provide that kind of impetus. So very excited about that, and that's the kind of thing in terms of urban development and economic development that I believe our city is capable of. Now, Councilor Stegmann did a fantastic job listing off many other things that our city is doing, and I appreciate that. She's done a fantastic job. We're going to miss her tremendously. She's been fantastic. Appreciate Councilor French, a fantastic source. This guy spends more time working on behalf of our citizens than anybody else. He's a great example to anybody who wants to serve other people. Appreciate that. It comes down to families. You know, there's a lot of problems in the world, but at the end of the day, if the family unit is solid, those problems go away. That's really what we need to go back to. And this is what I see Gresham being, is a family-oriented, family-loving environment. I am on a subcommittee for helping to brand Gresham. You know, perception, unfortunately, means too much. Sometimes perception to people is reality. And unfortunately, sometimes there's some negative perceptions in our local area. And so I want to fight and through this branding process help reconnect people, not only nationally in terms of bringing businesses here, but also locally and letting them know that this really is a family-oriented city, that this is a business-oriented city, that we want to get out of the way of business and help them do what they do best. And that is to create family-based jobs for our citizens and to create ultimately a tax base that helps, again, provide services for all those around us. I'm here to not aggrandize myself, but to aggrandize the city of Gresham. And I'm grateful for the opportunities I have to serve. We have many, many issues. I appreciate Chief Sells here today and congratulate her on her her appointment as chief. We have crime here. We had an individual who was just stabbed repeatedly, a 20-year-old boy, and found face down in Main City Park just a couple days ago. Tragic, horrible. We had a rape just the other day, allegedly by a homeless man to a young gal, 19 years old, walking to work in the morning. There are issues here. And those issues, I am so grateful for the great men and women we have in our police department who, quite frankly, track these folks down in a very, very quick manner and to put them behind bars. This is a city where we need to feel protected, and we feel comforted in living here and feeling comfortable in having our family be here with us. So there was another point I wanted to make about that, but I'm getting the minute mark here, so I'm going to go ahead and wrap up. Again, it's a pleasure to serve. It's an honor to serve. Again, the staff of the city of Gresham is far none. You know, these folks are solid individuals, professionals in every way. Joe Walsh and his team with Newton and what he's doing with the homeless folks, you know, fantastic. And the net team, all those folks doing a great job. You know, we've had a lot of that influx of the homelessness from Portland. Excited about working with our councils, excited about working with Ted Wheeler, the future mayor of Portland. I think we'll be able to work together in a great way in helping Portland take responsibility for the problems that they've helped create, quite frankly, in pushing lots of those folks out here. They've got the infrastructure, they've got the financial ability, and we will do all we can to help work with them and the state of Oregon to possibly even declare that a state of emergency in terms of providing that. We can't put camps here. We can't put micro houses here. We can't do that here, which would just exacerbate the current problem. We need to push back and help Portland take care of their responsibility to take care of those most vulnerable people. We want to be compassionate. We want to be able to care for those around us, but there's a way to do it. And there needs to be a process to do that. We need the help of everybody in the state of Oregon to do that as well. Unfortunately, up to 80% of these folks are mentally incapacitated. And you throw in the addictions, that just exacerbates the problem. And all that together provides a recipe for disaster. And so there needs to be more collaboration within the jurisdictions in the state to do that. Again, thank you so much. Appreciate it. It's an honor to be here.
Questions for Councilman Hinton? Come on, somebody has to ask him a question. He'll feel bad if he doesn't get one.
I feel bad.
Okay, Sue.
Honestly.
Here we go.
Sue.
So indeed, the last few years, the city of Gresham has actually really stepped up to the plate looking at the issues that are here, and I really greatly appreciate that. Moving into some of the areas of services that we never as a city thought we needed to do. But sort of that's a comment, but it leads into I was severely disappointed that we were not able to pass the measure for the community center, and I think that is a really key piece for this city. And so my question is, will the council continue to look at that? I think we just didn't do enough of a good job of helping people really understand it. So my question is, will that continue to be on the plans for the future?
Right. Absolutely. If you ask 100 people in a survey what is the one thing that Gresham needs, most of them are going to say a community center. They've said that over and over and over again. I think the council is unified and committed to providing a community center. I think the appetite in terms of the affordability coming again so close from the Great Recession just quite wasn't right in terms of the timing, particularly with the $200 million bond sitting right next to it for this. And I'm very, very grateful that they got that bond passed, and we'll be able to get some of these buildings restructured for our children. But unfortunately, that didn't happen. It will happen eventually. I think this community should have two community centers, quite frankly. In the meantime, we want to have a conversation with the school districts, which they've also commented on prior to the election, interested in looking at their schools as community centers. What can we do to turn these places, these schools, this fixed asset, this sunk cost, into a community center that would provide some of those meeting rooms, recreational facilities, and so on in the meantime? Use something we've already got.
Another question? Kind of a piggyback to the question that Sue asked. I had three people in the last 5 days, three businesses in the last 5 days that wanted to have a function in Gresham, looking for a location that would house about 150 people. And I wish I could have said, we have an amazingly new, classy community center that's just right for your big group. And one of those businesses was from Portland. So just a heads up, there's revenue that's left on the table, not
having we need to work with the business community, too, on anything and everything. Henry Ford, you know, his business wouldn't have gotten very far if he relied on just the constituents that he sells cars to. In fact, if he said that if you did a survey of what your customer wants, he said that they would just
horses.
Want a faster horse.
Yeah, faster
right?
horse. I love
so
that
sometimes
one.
It's the responsibility of the local business and the local government to work together so we can get past some of those low ceilings, low expectations.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, I agree. Another question? If not, thank you very much, Councillor Warner.
So it seems appropriate that batting cleanup would be our Chief of Police, Robin Sills. City of Gresham announced Robin Sills will be appointed police chief after a national search. Sills, who previously served as the Gresham Police Department's deputy chief, served as interim chief during the search. The opportunity for new and creative approaches to the current police structure puts Gresham at the forefront of innovation, says Chief Sills. This is an outstanding community and a top-notch department poised for continued progress. Chief Sills first joined the department in 2015 as deputy chief. She has more than 30 years of law enforcement experience in Oregon and California, having served in nearly every position. The guest speaker at a graduation ceremony featuring the Boys and Girls Club and sponsored by Soroptimus. Sounds like Gresham. Well, this happened in Buena Park, California. She shared some of the history of how she came to be a police chief and a police officer in Buena Park, and is not so easy climb it took to get her to the rank as captain. There wasn't a woman's locker room when I started in my career, and it wasn't easy for being the first female officer on the force. Sills says, life is not easy. I kept hitting walls, and you're going to hit walls and have challenges, but don't give up on your dream. Obviously, Chief Sills did not give up. From Buena Park Police Department, where she rose through the ranks, to our newly appointed police chief, to the fourth largest city in Oregon, welcome Police Chief Robin Sills.
Thank you. I first have to thank the city council members that are here, and thank you for your confidence and your trust in giving me this police department. The fact is not lost on me that this is a very daunting position, and I appreciate both what you have given me as well as the city manager and our mayor as well. It's funny because this is not a job that I looked for. I was never that recruit that sat in the police academy and said, yeah, I'm going to be a chief. This is the furthest thing from my mind. It was not on my bucket list. Even when I came here as deputy chief, that was not my intent. So how did I get here? As he said, I spent 29 years in law enforcement in California. I rose to the ranks of captain in Buena Park, and people go, where's Buena Park? Most people don't know. Farhad knows because we had a chat earlier. He went to high school right next to Buena Park. But if I say Knott's Berry Farm, then you probably go, oh, okay, now I get it. That's Buena Park. And I did enjoy my time there, but I retired, and I was very happily retired when I got the call from Chief Jenniger that said, hey, I've got an opening for a deputy chief. Could you come up here for 1 year assignment and help me mentor some people and do some special projects for me? And I said, no, thank you, and hung up. Well, those of you that know Chief Jenniger, he doesn't give up easily. And he called a second time, and I thought, this guy is just not gonna go away. I did know Chief Jenniger down in California. He worked at a department that I had worked for as well. So I said, what the heck, you know, for a year I can do anything. And I came up here again, not with the intent to ever becoming the chief here. And I started here, we started making some good progress, and Chief Jenniger decided to retire. So I was asked to be the interim chief, and I thought, I can do that for a little bit. And then the more I thought about it, I really wasn't ready to leave. Somebody said the city grew on you, and it actually did. The men and women of this police department are so amazing that I really feel that we are making a difference here in Gresham, and that's the only reason I stayed. I say I fell in love. Yeah, I fell in love with Gresham Police Department. That's what happened. And we are doing some amazing things. Let me start with giving you a little bit of background. People always ask me, how did you get into law enforcement itself? And there's a reason for this story. Back when I was about 17 years old, that was a long time ago, I went to a drugstore and I saw some guy actually steal a bicycle, this little girl's bicycle, right in front of me. And so I thought, I'm gonna follow this guy. And you know, now that I recognize with my police experience, I was probably following a parolee, but I didn't have the knowledge to know that at the time, again, being a high school student. So I followed him in my little Datsun station wagon, which some of you probably don't even know what a Datsun is, but so I followed him into a residential area, and pretty soon he gets off the bicycle and he dumps it and he takes off running. So I get out and I put this bicycle in the back of my Datsun station wagon, and I went back to the store. And when I got back to the store, the police department was already there. I lived in Huntington Beach and was a Huntington Beach police officer. And he went on and on about what a hero I was to have recovered this bicycle. And I also got the license plate of the car that he eventually jumped into. So I solved the crime. That was my first crime that I ever solved. I was 17. So just the interaction between that officer and myself is what sparked my interest in law enforcement. And the reason why I tell you this story is because I tell our officers on a daily basis, you don't know the impact you're having on people. One contact can make a difference, and that officer made a difference to me, and I want to make sure our officers continue to make that same contact with each and every one of you. My mantra kind of is, and I, those that have heard me before probably are getting tired of hearing it, but our job is to know our community before we need to know our community. Law enforcement is a tough business these days. And when I look out here and I recognize some of the faces, that makes me feel good, because I know I'm in the right direction. Because there's going to come a time when I need to knock on your door and say, I need some help. And I know you all will be there. So just to give you a little idea of some of the things that we have been doing is we've been working with some of our partners at, we've been working hard with the Latino Network. Recently, we did a listening session with them. And I think we tend to forget our Latino community within Gresham. It's a large percentage of our population here. The demographics, I believe, are 14% of the Latinos that we have in Gresham. And nobody ever talks about them. I only have 12 officers that speak Spanish. That's not enough. And so what happens is a lot of times these folks are afraid to make that phone call because they're afraid that we won't be able to understand them and hear what they need. So we went to this listening session. It was right after the election. And they were incredibly saddened that Donald Trump had gotten elected. And they were afraid that we, the police department here in Gresham, were going to come and deport them. And it was a real fear. Some of the officers kind of laughed and said, oh, that's silly. But it's silly to us. But it's a real fear to them. We spent over 2.5 hours with them. It was the school district, the police department. We had an immigration attorney there talking and hearing their fears and trying to calm them down that we are not ICE. We are not going to, we're not here to put you in jail. And so just those type of things, getting out in the community and talking at these listening sessions, I think is what's going to bring us, make us a better police department. My goal here is to make sure that we become the best police department in the state of Oregon. I would like to see more police officers on the street, but at this time it's not possible. So we're going to make good use of the resources that we have, and I'm going to try and be smart for all of you and put them in the right places, whether I have to shift some people on day shift and put them on nights. We'll make it happen, I promise you. So. Some of the things that we want to accomplish during this time is some public education as well. Recently, we did a public education on active shooter training. And that's not a how-to, that's what to do if you are if you find yourself in an active shooter situation. We think about that. Why are we even having that conversation? And the reason we're having it is because it's real. It's real. You all know, I wasn't here when Reynolds School District happened, but you all know that that's a definite possibility. So we provided this education at City Hall, and we started with our City Hall employees, and then we did it for the public. And my hope was like maybe 10 people would show up. And I would think that that would be, it would have been successful. And we had over 75 people show up. And after that, people were asking us for even more. They said, can you come to our business and show us each business and do a safety check? And we want to be that resource for you. I promise you, you call us, we will make sure that it happens. I can't give the time period, but we'll make sure that it will happen. One of the other things that we did recently was the Springwater Trail. Our council asked us to start patrolling the trail a little bit more. The fence was put up to help the habitat that was out there. So we thought we would just be going up and down the trail and saving the fence. That's what we did. But you know, the unintended consequence for that was that while we're out on the trail, and I don't know if you've seen it, it's called the Gator, and that's what the officers are out there. And Joan's smiling because she's actually been in the Gator before. And so, so the Gator patrol went every single day during the summer. And the unintended consequence of that was that every single day, our officers got to make contact with some of you, and the people on the trail would stop them and tell them how safe that they felt as a result of that. So just small things like that, we're building bridges in this community, and we want to continue doing that. Our community engagement in the schools is huge. We currently have 6 school resource officers. They do an amazing job. Recently, I had asked if we could have an officer go out to one of the schools for the first day of school. The principal had contacted me and said, can we just have an officer out there and greet the kids? So I went into roll call and I said, could I have an officer meet over at Hollydale School? And I didn't get one officer. I got 6. That's how important community engagement has become to these officers. I can't tell you the number of different events, and I think the council finally got tired of me being the cheerleader, sending them all the events that we do. But it's good for our community to see the officers out there. The trust that we build with you, we need that trust. We can't solve crimes without you. And just a point that Councilor Hinton made was about a recent rape that we had, and it was a homeless person that we ended up arresting. I would like to stand up here and say it was incredibly good police work, and we did so much on our own, but the bottom line is it was a tip from one of the community members that led us to that gentleman. I guess it's not a gentleman, but that's what I'm talking about, is the trust that we build with you. We can't solve all these crimes ourselves. We need your help. So, and also along the lines of the incident that happened this past weekend, that was not a stranger situation. And I can't tell you a whole lot more, but I want you to feel safe in your community. Main City Park is still safe. That was a very incredibly unusual event. It's not normal. Please keep using the park. It's the showcase of our city. And that's one thing I would really ask you is don't let people win. That's not going to happen here in Gresham as long as I'm the chief. Like I said, this was not on my bucket list. I am incredibly proud to be here, and I look forward to a long period of time here, and thank you again. I'm getting the hook back there.
Don't go away. We're going to have a question for you. A question for Officer.
Thank you for being here, and I just had a quick question, and to kind of kudos on the fact that you said that you want to have more community engagement. You know, being a diversity person like me and a different ethnicity, I come from a community where we don't like the blue. We stay away from it. And it's not because that we just don't like, dislike you, but it's just the fact that we're so afraid of what happened in the past. And so from a community that I'm engaged of, and I'm in quite heavily, I think the perception is real, and the biggest thing I could say is that the more you outreach about how to get the community involved within the Latino community, within the Middle Eastern community, and just be there and show yourself and be open to questions, and I think that would open up so much routes and development and the growth of the department as well, and for the community at a whole. So I think kudos, keep doing what you're doing, and it's the right steps, I believe. Yeah.
Thank you. And along those lines, we have a listening session tomorrow night. Bishop Stephen Holt, I don't know how many of you actually know him. He has been holding listening sessions over at the Sunrise Center down there in Burnside the second Wednesday of every month. And our officers have turned out in droves. And these officers are there not on their working day. They come in on their day off. I had one show up one day in shorts and flip-flops because he wanted to be there. It was that important to him to be there. But you're absolutely right. So many of our community members, I was told 88 different cultures here in Gresham, which that number just astounds me. I can't even fathom that. And we have to be able to cater to each and every one of those. We can't know all the cultures. There's no way. But we want to make sure that we give all the cultures an opportunity to talk with us and get to know us, because I think you're right. The fact that back home, wherever the home was, the police department was not a good thing. People get executed, they get put in jail, and so it's up to us to make sure that we extend that hand so that they see that we're just real people, you know? I just want that to be an ongoing conversation. We call it courageous conversations, but it really is, because, just in the Latino ones that we had, they would bring up specific events and want to know why we did something we did, and just to have that opportunity to explain to them our procedures or why we're doing something, you see the light go on both sides, not just for the police, but for the community as well. So thank you for that. Sue?
Well, first a comment and then a question for you. We have one of your police officers living in our neighborhood, and we were chatting with him over the weekend at kind of a neighborhood gathering, and he said that within the department that they were very concerned that they would not be able to keep you through this process, and that within the department you were absolutely the person that they felt was the right person for the job. So wanted to let you know he shared that with many of our neighbors, and so that was really good to hear. And again, just here's an officer who really is very connected within all of his neighborhood, in a fairly large neighborhood, and everybody knows him, and so that's another evidence of what a great department. But you mentioned earlier, and I wanted to ask you, you talked about emergency situations And since we manage a number of buildings in the Gresham area, is that something that we could have maybe a conversation with someone within the department so that we could maybe have some sort of a plan that we might talk about and provide to tenants in buildings?
Absolutely. And what comes to mind immediately is our community resource team, and I think most of you know it as the NET team. And what's unique about this team, it's four officers and a sergeant, and they don't answer the daily radio calls. So they have the freedom to be able to go out to businesses and take the time, and they're not giving you, oh, I've got to hurry because I've got a call. They get the time to spend with you and be able to go through and give you safety tips. They have something they call CEPTED, which is Crime Prevention Through Environmental Design. I know it's a long acronym, but what it means is, you know, maybe your business has too many bushes in the front, and that's providing shielding people that want to sleep there at night. So they'll come in and talk to you and say, you need to remove those bushes. They're beautiful, but you need to remove them for the safety of your employees or your business. So yes, absolutely. Our community resource team would be happy to help you in that.
Any other questions for the chief? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, as promised, did any of you think of a question you wanted to ask of someone that has already spoken? No? Okay, then we're going to call it a wrap. I want to just remind Mayor-elect Ryan, he has said this a number of times, and Lori, this goes for you too. You have been an elected official, but now you're going into a different role. Chief, you're going into a different role as well, and you may not feel equipped to do that, but I want to remind you that if it took experience to do something, we never would have walked on the moon. So just do it. Just use your character, use your good strength, use us as sounding boards, and then make good decisions, fair decisions, and we know that you will. So I want to thank Jerry and Lori and Casey and Robin for being here with us. And I also want to thank Persimmon. Darn good meal that I didn't have to cook, and I really appreciate that. Thank you again to our sponsors, Portland General Electric. John, thanks for being here today. And Riverview Bank, thank you also, Larry. Gresham Barlow School District, MetroEast Community Media, thank you very much, Keith. Flyers again for the replay times are on the registration table. Please fill out the evaluation forms. Larry loves to see what a good job he did by getting the speakers here, so do that. And just a quick announcement. Starting in 2017, our lunches are going to be still on Tuesdays, but it's going to be the third week of the month rather than the second week of the month. And our first speaker in January to start the year off is going to be amazing. His name is Bill Wyatt, and he's with the Port of Portland. He may have something to say about Amazon, about some of the other programs that are coming, the TRIP program or the VISTA. So I can't wait for that. And thank you very much, Larry, for making that happen. So that is on the third Tuesday of the month, date to be determined. Please have a Merry Christmas, all of you. See you later. Bye-bye.